Just to kind of set this scene up for you a little bit as far as historically before we actually read the chapter. At this time frame in Israel's history, they've already been, the time frame's already taken place where King Solomon rebelled against God, and because of that, the kingdom was split, and the people and the kings of Israel, the northern kingdom, and then even it ventured down into the southern kingdom, were disobedient towards the ways of God, and God had sent the prophets to warn them, and because of their repeated refusal of listening to the prophets of God, God had promised that their enemy was going to gain captivity over them. You know, it's for me, it was so clear whenever I began to read the Old Testament after the Lord got a hold of me that it was God was writing the story twice, if you will, that in reality this same thing can happen to believers. That we as the people of God, we serve God, and He speaks to us through His Word, and He sends the preaching of the gospel to our hearts, but yet many times we have our own plans and we go our own way, and that we need to understand that whenever that happens, God really in His mercy will allow the enemy to gain captivity over our lives again. We call that in the New Testament a resurgence of the old nature. A resurgence of the sinful nature can gain power again over the believer. That was never God's will for Israel. It was never God's will for Israel that their enemies be king over them, that their enemies have control and dominion over them. And it's never God's will for the New Testament believer that the sinful nature reign as king over his heart. But the reality of it is that if we don't follow after God and His ways, that very thing can and does happen if we don't keep our eyes focused on God's way and God's plan. So God's way and God's plan has never changed. It's always been Jesus. Amen. It's always been Jesus, not just who He was, but Jesus, what He was coming to do, which was to die for the sins of humanity. And we see, though, in this particular time frame that because of their disobedience, that they've already been taken captive by the Babylonian Empire, and so many things have happened, not to go through the whole process, but now they've been given an edict by King Cyrus, the Persian king, to go back and to rebuild the temple. And so that has taken place, that Israel has gone back and the temple is being rebuilt. That's the time frame of Zechariah the prophet. We studied that not that long ago, and whenever that temple was rebuilt, you know, the crowds were out there. They saw the rebuilding of the temple, and many people were joyous and cheerful, and then some were saddened because they remembered the old Solomonic temple, the one from Solomon, and how beautiful and how large it was, and they looked at this one and how it paled in comparison, and so some were sad, some were happy, and essentially that's the time frame that's going on, right? So there should be some joyous occasion because they've been prisoner. You know, you in your life as a Christian, if you've ever found yourself in the midst of a circumstance or a situation where you felt captive, you didn't feel like you were free in a particular area of your life, but then the Lord moved in and He brought freedom. It should bring joy when the Lord brings freedom. Amen. And even in the midst of this time frame of Israel's history where Zechariah is the prophet and he's speaking at a time whenever things should be joyous, he warns that there's coming a day in the future when it's going to still be bad for Jerusalem. There's going to be a really bad day ahead on the horizon. And so really, there's some things that have already happened in Israel's past when Zechariah prophesies. But in chapter 12, he's speaking to a specific day in the future. A day when all the nations of the earth are going to come against the apple of God's eye, the nation that He created Himself out of that man named Abraham. They're going to all come against the nation of Israel. That's what the Bible says. And it's going to be a horrible, horrible day for Israel on that day. But at the same time, it's going to be the best day that Israel could have ever imagined, because it's going to be on that day that there's not going to be anywhere else to turn. There's no more strength in themselves. There's no more way that they can accomplish anything in their own strength or get anything done on their own. And the reality of it is that they are going to have to look to the one whom God had sent them the first time. Yeah. And they are going to be delivered in the midst of that calamity. So that is essentially the idea behind what we're going to read in chapter 12. And so let's just go ahead and read the whole chapter. And if the Lord tells me to, we'll talk a little bit about it as we go. Zechariah chapter 12, verse 1. The burden of the word of the Lord for Israel, saith the Lord, which stretcheth forth the heavens and layeth the foundation of the earth, and formeth the spirit of man within him. As a matter of fact, I would like to stop right there and just point out a couple of things. Number one, we're going to talk about the fact that Israel is going to face a calamity like she's never faced before at some point in time. God starts this whole chapter off by reminding Israel who he is. He's the God that formeth, he's the God who stretched forth the heavens, laid the foundations of the earth, and he's also the God that formeth the spirit within man. God wants you and I to know that whenever you find yourself in the midst of situations and you don't really know how to get out of it, he wants you to be remind yourself. He wants Israel to be reminded right here at this point in time that he is the one who laid the heavens. He's the one that laid the foundation of the earth. And he's the one that put the spirit within man. So no matter what it is that you find yourself going through, no matter what it is that you face in this physical life, you need to understand that the God you serve is the creator of the universe, and he's the one that gave you breath in your lungs.
Amen.
He's the one that keeps the breath in your lungs. Amen. And he's the one that's going to keep you going in the midst of it all.
Amen.
I guess what I'm trying to say is that there's nothing too big that God can't intervene
that's
in the midst
true.
Of. Amen. And that God cannot bring deliverance out of. Amen.
Amen.
He goes on to say in verse 2, behold, I will make Jerusalem a cup of trembling unto the people round about, when they shall be in the siege both against Judah and against Jerusalem. And in that day will I make Jerusalem a burdensome stone for all the people that burden themselves with it shall be cut in pieces, though all the people of the earth be gathered together against it. In that day, says the Lord, I will smite every horse with astonishment and his rider with madness, and I will open mine eyes upon the house of Judah and will smite every horse of the people with blindness. And the governors of Judah shall say in their heart, the inhabitants of Jerusalem shall be my strength in the Lord of hosts, their God. In that day will I make the governors of Judah like a hearth of fire among the wood, and like a torch of fire in a sheaf, and they shall devour all the people round about them on the right hand and on the left, and Jerusalem shall be inhabited again in her own place, even in Jerusalem. The Lord shall also save the tents of Judah first, that the glory of the house of David and the glory of the inhabitants of Jerusalem do not magnify themselves against Judah. You know what he's saying right there? I mean, just as a side note so that we can understand what's going on. He's saying, I'm going to save the whole surrounding southern nation before I actually save the city of Jerusalem. Because if I don't do that, then the inhabitants of Jerusalem are going to lift themselves up and going to say, oh, we're the darlings of heaven. When in reality, no, there's no specific, God's not a respecter of persons. Amen. He loves each and every one of us. Jesus is the darling of heaven.
Amen.
Jesus is the focus of God's attention. And as long as you and I put our focus on him, then we're in the midst of God's will. But it never fails. Whenever God shows favor in somebody's life, they automatically, it's not uncommon for them to lift themselves up in pride and to magnify themselves, and they're like, oh, look at me, I'm the blessed one of God. Well, no, God wants to, but sometimes the rain falls on the godly and it falls on the ungodly too. Amen. And so just because you see things going on in people's lives and you can't automatically question and begin to believe, oh, they must not be serving the Lord the way that they may not be, but the reality of it is that sometimes God allows good things to happen to his people, because many times that's how God grabs a hold of the attention of his
Amen.
People. Anyway, says right here in verse 8, right? In that day shall the Lord defend the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and he that is feeble among them at that day shall be as David, and the house of David shall be as God, as the angel of the Lord before them. I like that part because I didn't really break it down in my notes. But, you know, basically what God's saying is in that day, this is a really bad day, and we'll talk a little bit more about it in a moment. But there's really, this is a situation where there's no hope. There, like, in the physical, when you look at the circumstance, there's no way out of this. The Gentile nations are going to come against Israel. But what the word of God says right here is that on that day, God's going to infuse his spirit in his people, and the feeblest among them is going to be like David. You know, David was the greatest warrior that Israel ever had. Amen. You think about that little shepherd boy, you know the story, right? About how he went out there against that giant with those, and he found those smooth rocks in the brook Kidron, and he fell that giant on that day, took that giant's own sword and cut his head off. And I mean, the songs went forward from that day about David, and the women would sing about him and how David slayed thousands upon thousands. And you know, he was known as the greatest warrior. The Word of God saying that, that's something for you and I to understand too, that no matter how weak you think you are, I'm talking spiritual. Like, no matter how weak you think you are, you need to understand something. God's the one that shows up and infuses with the power of His Holy Spirit and makes the weakest amongst us like a David, like a warrior in the kingdom of God. It's not anything that you did in and of yourself. No, it's not anything that they could do in and of themselves on that day. But instead, it was the Holy Spirit of God that infused them with the power from God and made them to be warriors to be able to do the work of God. Amen. And He does that in the New Testament. And the way that He does that is that He gets rid of the old man born of Adam.
Amen.
And He creates a new man born again in Christ. Amen. And as we keep faith in what Christ has done for us at the cross, it gives the Holy Spirit liberty and freedom to move and operate in our lives, to strengthen us, amen, and to make us go from being feeble, a feeble weakling, to a powerful warrior of God. Amen. There's hope in that. I don't know about you, but I'm telling you, there's hope in that. I've seen the power of God move and operate in the midst of our life. I'm talking about things that you could not get victory over. And that the Holy Spirit shows up and brings you victory.
Yes.
The Holy Spirit shows up and makes you strong. Amen. The Holy Spirit, because He wants to show to you, and He wants to show to them in this, on this day, He's going to show to them, you couldn't have done this.
Amen.
It was me. I had to show up and do it for you. Amen. He says in verse 9, "And it shall come to pass in that day that I will seek to destroy all the nations that come against Jerusalem. And I will pour out upon the house of David and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and of supplications. And they shall look upon me whom they have pierced. And they shall mourn for him as one mourns for his only son, and shall be in bitterness for him as one that is in bitterness for his firstborn." I didn't really put it in the notes, so if they could go to Revelation chapter 19, I'd like to tell you what I believe to be. I'll try to make, kind of bring all the pieces together, but I believe that this is a moment in time that's spoken of in the book of Revelation, chapter 19, starting in verse 12. Well, really, we can start verse 11. Revelation 19, verse 11. "And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself." You know where he got those crowns from, by the way? He got them from people like you, amen? People that gave their heart to the Lord. The Bible says in the book of Revelation chapter 5 that whenever the elders came before the throne, before the Lamb, they took their crowns from off their head and they laid them at the feet of Jesus. The truth is that whenever you and I give our heart to the Lord, and when you and I find ourselves in circumstances where we cannot overcome, and we allow the Holy Spirit to make us who were feeble a warrior like David, and He gives us the strength and power to live out our Christianity upon this earth. Amen.
Amen.
Everybody doesn't stand behind a pulpit and preach, but everybody is supposed to live their life for the Lord. And whenever you live your life for the Lord and you use your life as a vessel to bring Jesus to other people, wherever it is that you do that. Some people do it in a doctor's office. Some people do it at a restaurant. Some people do it on a job location. Wherever it is that you're doing it, the reality of it is that as long as you're doing it, you're doing the work of the Lord. It's called personal evangelism, and it's written in the scriptures that that's the way it's supposed to be. That's true New Testament Christianity. I'm just letting you know that. Now, a lot of churches won't teach you that, but I'm here to tell you the truth, that you're supposed to live Jesus on the inside of you. Amen? You don't think the disciples just talked about Him inside four walls. Matter of fact, a lot of times they had church outside, but nevertheless, you don't think that the disciples just held on to Jesus during the service, do you? No. They brought Jesus with them everywhere that they went. And whenever you live your life for the Lord, you're receiving a crown, but the crown's not for you to hold on and flaunt around and to be like all lifted up about yourself and everything that you accomplished. You know, all through our lives, how, you know, whenever you play sports, some of y'all know what I'm talking about. You got all them trophies up in your room, you know, and like, oh, yeah, look what I did here. Look what I did there. No, those trophies perish. Paul talked about the fact that some of these crowns perish, some of these trophies perish, but that we were working towards an award that did not perish, that it was eternal. Amen. Because it's a crown that glorifies God, and ultimately we're going to give it back to Him. So here he is, and he's got these many crowns on his head, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. He was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. That vesture that's dipped in blood right there, that's his own blood, amen? That's descriptive of the sacrifice of Jesus. He's coming back in victory because he came as the Lamb of God the first time. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, and out. You know what that means? That's descriptive of your righteousness. You were clothed with white linen. You were clothed in righteousness because of the sight. See, his vesture, his clothing is full of blood, but the believer's clothing is righteous. It's white. Because of the shedding of his blood, you were able to be clothed with the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, and that with it he should smite the nations. It means he's going to destroy them, those that rise up against God. He shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treads the winepress, that's descriptive of judgment, of the fierceness and the wrath of Almighty God. And he has on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. What I want you to know is this, is that on this day, this is descriptive of Jesus coming back to the earth. Amen. Jesus coming back to the earth for the battle of Armageddon, to bring destruction upon all those that come against God and against God's people. And for all of this time that human history has been around, all of humanity that has come against God. Sometimes it's hard to believe when you haven't really been real spiritually minded to learn to believe the Bible for the way that it's written. It's like you try to manufacture all this stuff in your mind. Well, how's all this going to look? I don't know exactly how it's going to look. I'm just telling you, Jesus is coming back to this earth again. Amen. He's going to rule and reign as king upon this earth. That's what the Word of God says. Amen. About Jesus. And so I want you to know that in this day that we're reading about, that the prophet Zechariah is talking about, that's whenever this is going to happen. That they're going to look upon, Israel is going to look upon the one whom they pierced. I believe he'll still have the nail scars in his hands, but he's going to look a whole lot different than he did on the day that he rode in on the donkey. It's going to be a whole different. They're going to look upon the one whom they pierced, and they're going to mourn for him as one mourns for an only son. They're going to realize that they did something wrong at that point in time. It's going to be full of bitterness, the pain that they're going to feel, the remorse that they're going to feel for going against God. They're going to realize that it's going to result in a great day of repentance on that day. It says in verse 11, in that day there shall be great mourning in Jerusalem, as the mourning of Hadadrimmon in the valley of Megiddon. What they're remembering back then is that there was a king named Josiah. Y'all ever heard about Josiah? A lot of Christian women named their sons Josiah because of what an awesome king he was. I'm shooting from the hip here. I think he was about 8 when he took the throne. Something like that. He was about 8 years old when he took the throne. It wasn't long after he was king, once he started to understand what was called of him, that he just started cleaning house. I mean, the house of God was filled with idolatry and various forms of pagan temple worship. He took all of that stuff out of the house. He killed the prophets. He had the prophets killed, burned them, crushed up their bones, threw them in the brook, Kidron. I mean, this guy was for real. He said, no, we're going to clean house. Well, there was a day when he chose to go to war against Egypt. And he got shot by an arrow in the process, and he ended up dying. And Israel mourned greatly on that day. They had wanted him not to go to war, but he went to war, and he ended up dying. And when they realized that king who had restored the kingdom, who had brought the presence of God back to the people of Israel, that there was great mourning on that day. They said, it's going to be like that on this day, whenever all these Gentile nations come against Israel. It says, verse 12, and the land shall mourn every family apart, the family of the house of David apart, and their wives apart, the family of the house of Nathan apart, and their wives apart. You see how that, it's real descriptive. It's not talking about Israel as a whole. It's talking about specific people. It's talking about individuals mourning this day that's coming. The family of the house of Levi apart, their wives apart. The family of Shimei apart, and their wives apart. All the families that remain, every family apart, and their wives apart. And so once again, this whole day describes the great day of the Battle of Armageddon, and it describes the day that Jesus is coming back to the earth, and it describes the fact that Israel has really not been living for God the way that they were supposed to. Even now, to be honest with you, in a political sense, whenever we turn on the television, we see these various politicians taking their stance on whether or not they're going to stand with Israel, and this one says, I'm going to stand with Israel, and this side says, they're not going to stand with Israel. But the reality of it is that we need to vote for politicians that are going to stand with Israel. Israel are God's people. We're about Israel. Amen. We should be praying for the peace of Israel. But I can tell you that Israel right now is in disobedience towards God. Israel is not in covenant with God. Israel rejected God and his plan. Israel rejected Messiah. And so they are not serving God the way that they are supposed to be serving God. In reality, right now, they're in rebellion against God. And on this day, though, they're going to come to the realization of what's been taking place. But what's going to happen is that they're going to realize that they were deceived on this day. Now, I don't know what your persuasion is as far as for what you believe regarding the rapture of the church. You know, I'll be honest with you. I know that we got various people in here. Some people believe in a strict pre-tribulation rapture. Some people believe in more of a mid-tribulation rapture. What I want you to know, though, is that if you could put up 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 3 through 4. I want you to know that I believe that there's a certain time frame of events that are going to take place that are going to be the impetus to cause all of this that we're talking about on this day. And it says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 3 through 4, this is the Apostle Paul in the New Testament. He said, let no man deceive you by any means for that day. He's talking about that day right there that we just read about in Zechariah. Shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Now, I got to tell you that some people teach that falling away first as though that's the rapture of the church. That word there in the Greek is apostasia, and it means a defection or rebellion. So essentially, what we're expecting to see is that there's a rebellion from the Word of God, that the church, even the people of God, would turn away from the very Word of God. They would still have a form of godliness, but deny the power thereof. That's happening to us right now. We're seeing all of that take place. But more specifically, what's going to happen to Israel is that, and I believe that the time frame, the 7-year time frame, is spoken mostly like no other place in the book of Daniel. We talked about this the other night. And maybe it is a pre-tribulation that is the impetus that causes this covenant to be confirmed or signed or whatever you want to talk about it. But there's no other place in the Bible that talks about 7 years like the book of Daniel. And essentially it talks about a prince, and it's talking about the Antichrist. You just got to kind of take my word for this because we don't have time to break it down. But the Antichrist comes together and he signs an agreement with the people of Israel. But in the middle of that agreement, he breaks that agreement. And I'm just saying that it seems as though to me that when he breaks that agreement, this would also be the time frame that he does this right here, where he exalts himself in the temple of God. He says that I am God and that mankind is to worship me. And so this would be a mid-tribulation point. But it's at this point in time that Israel realizes that they've been deceived. Oh, they've been deceived. They've been in rebellion for a long time up to this point. They've been in rebellion ever since the day that Jesus rode into town on a donkey. And the reality of it is that many times we as individual believers have been deceived by the enemy. And we've been living in rebellion for a long period of time. And the longer we live in rebellion, the harder it is to see that we've even been in rebellion. But nevertheless, God's plan is here to deliver them and to bring them liberty and freedom. So he breaks this covenant with them. He exalts himself on the throne to be worshipped as God. And furthermore, his power over the rest of the world influences all these nations to come against Israel, as we read about in Zechariah chapter 12. He has dominion over the majority of the world is what it looks like. The whole world is going to essentially fall into league with him, except for maybe a couple of nations or whatever the case. But what I want you to know is this, is that as I was studying this and thinking about this whole scenario, it's not just the will of the enemy that's coming against Israel in all of this. And we've talked about these types of things before. But if you think about this, it's always, no matter what happens, whether it be in this grand, large situation that's taking place or in your individual lives, your will's involved too. Mankind's will's involved. The enemy's will's involved. God's will's involved. What are you trying to say, preacher? I'm trying to say that in every situation and circumstance, there's a little bit of a mixture of all three. And what I mean by that is that if you go to Psalm chapter 2, verses 1 through 3, you can see where the will of man is involved in coming against Israel as a nation. It says right here in these short verses right here, why do the heathen rage? Y'all know what heathen are, right? These are the people that don't know God. These are the nations that aren't in covenant with God. These are the people that are not Israel. And the people imagine a vain thing. The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. Now, not to get too deep into this, but this spirit's been alive upon the earth since the rebellion in the garden and really began to manifest itself at the Tower of Babel. But the reality of it is that it's been, this spirit of rebellion has been in the hearts of men, in the hearts of kings for thousands and thousands of years. But it's going to culminate in this day that we're talking about regarding the prophet Zechariah and what is going to happen. But what I need you to know is that this is the will of man. This is the will of man in conjunction with the will of the enemy coming against the plan of God. And whether, once again, it be this big picture that we're talking about the nations of the earth, or whether it be you and me in our individual lives, that we have our own will, and sometimes we go against the will of God. We need to be aware of that. We need to come to grips with that. We need to face that reality that sometimes man's will contradicts the will of God, and we go in our own direction. But you got to understand, there's also the will of Satan. In Revelation chapter 16, verses 13 through 14, it says right here, and this is talking about that last day, this getting prepared for the Battle of Armageddon. It says, I saw three unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon, and out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. For they are the spirits of devils. This is talking about demonic spirits, working miracles which go forth unto the kings of the earth and of the whole world to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty. So you see, in the Psalm passage, it's the will of men. They don't want, there's men out there that don't want to submit to the will of God. And the enemy is more than happy to find those men and to release these demonic type spirits to cause them to go in another direction. And the enemy of your soul will do the same for you. If you have your own will, he will try to lead and guide you in a direction that is opposite of what God's will is for the midst of your life. He goes on to say that there's also a will, the will of God, amen, in all of this. It's Revelation chapter 16, just the next couple of verses over, 15 and 16. This is Jesus talking again. He says, behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watches and keeps his garments, lest he walks naked and they see his shame. And he gathered them together into a place in the Hebrew tongue called Armageddon. So ultimately, it was always God's will that they end up in the Valley of Armageddon. Satan can do whatever it is that he wants. Mankind can come against God in opposition any kind of way that he wants. This is reassuring to me. This reminds me that God is ultimately in control, amen, and that he's watching everything and he knows it all. He's the master chess player. Amen. Mankind's not going to outwit God, and Satan's not going to outwit God. The whole time, they may think that they're doing something to accomplish something on the earth, but God is sovereign. And he's working in the midst of it all. Amen. And he is accomplishing his desire for all of this. Ultimately, I need you to know that God is in control. For God's people, it will seem like an impossible situation. It will appear there's no way of escape, but he will supernaturally intervene and deliver them in a way that they will know that it was only him. If you go back to Zechariah chapter 12, verse 2, I wanted to just kind of tell you that the next couple of things I talk about are really going to talk about the supernatural aspect of how God's going to bring deliverance on this day for Israel. And the reason I want to point that out is because you don't war against flesh and blood. I'm kind of going back and forth between the big picture and your life. Amen. The fact that while all this stuff is played out on the grand stage of humanity, where God has this big old thing going forward. Amen. And he's coming back for us. But at the same time, our individual lives, we're living this life out in our individual lives as we go along. I need you. But there's some definite similarities. And one of the things that I want you to see is that in the midst of all of this, that God is going to show up supernaturally for Israel, and that he's going to win the victory. And that sometimes you may find yourself in circumstances and situations, and you don't know how God's going to bring the deliverance, but you need to understand something. You don't war against flesh and blood. You war against principalities and powers. I always mess it up when I paraphrase it. Spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. World powers. Mm-hmm. I know I didn't do it in the right order, but I think I got most of them, right? Evil spirits. Mm-hmm. You're warring against spiritual entities that want to destroy you and want to destroy the plan of God. Mm-hmm. And so what I need you to know is that these next couple things we're going to talk about is God's intervention for Israel on that day. And you need to know that God will intervene for you also. And even though you find yourself in the midst of circumstances where it looks impossible, nothing is impossible for God. Remember, he's the one that laid the heavens, he founded the earth, and he formed the spirit on the inside of you. Amen. He said, "Behold, I will make Jerusalem a cup of trembling unto all the people round about, when they shall be in the siege both against Judah and against Jerusalem." When the Antichrist elevates himself and says that he is going to be God and to be worshipped of God, and the dragon spews out these demonic spirits, and all the nations of the earth, the Gentile nations, come against Jerusalem and Judah and surround it, and it looks like it's an impossible situation, God says it's going to look like a cup to them. They're real thirsty. You ever been real thirsty and you grab a hold of a cup and you said, "This cup, when I drink it, is going to fix what I got ailing me." They're going to pick that cup up, but what it's going to do is it's going to become a cup of trembling. Now, to our English mind, because that's an old King James way of saying it, it's not talking about trembling as in fear. It's talking about trembling as in intoxication. What they thought was going to cause them to take care of the thirst that they need and the lust for hunger and power that they were looking for, when they drink this cup, they're going to get so intoxicated by it that they're not even going to be able to think right. They're not going to be able to function properly. Confusion is going to begin to set in. See, this is God supernaturally manifesting himself in the midst of Israel's situation. Amen. And I need you to know that when you find yourself in circumstances that you can't get free of, what you need to know is that the enemy, he's always done it for Israel, and he'll still do it for you as a Christian today. He will cause confusion in the midst of the enemy's camp. I'm telling you right now, look, it says in Zechariah 12:3, "In that day I will make Jerusalem a burdensome stone for all people. All that burden themselves with it shall be cut in pieces, though all the people of the earth be gathered together against it." It's going to be a situation where all these nations come against Israel. It's going to be like, it's going to be simple to them, right? All these nations, it's like just like sipping out of a cup. All we got to do is just reach down there and grab a drink of that thing. It's going to be like a stone. Look at this powerful army we have. It's going to be like a little bitty old rock. We just reach down and pick that rock up. It's going to be real easy. But no, what it's going to say is that when they try to burden themselves with this stone, that they're going to be broken or literally cut and sized into pieces whenever this happens. What you and I need to understand, once again, this is another picture of the fact that God supernaturally intervening. The drink intoxicates them. The little rock that they're trying to pick up cuts them to pieces. And the reality of it is this, is that yes, you're in the midst of a spiritual warfare, but as silly as that looks, as easy as that is going to look to the kings of the earth to take control of Israel, it's the same thing that it looks like to the demonic forces in your personal life. When they look at you, they look to you as though you're just a little cup that they're going to take a drink of. They look to you as that you're just a little rock that they're going to grab a hold of, and they're going to bring destruction in the midst of your life. But what they don't understand is this whole thing that we call the cross, they don't understand how this thing really works. And the reality of it is that though it look weak, though it looks small to the natural eye, right? We've been talking about it. 1 Corinthians 1:18, the preaching of the cross is foolishness to them who perish, amen, but to you and I who are being saved, it is the power of God. It's foolishness to the Greek. It's a stumbling block to the Jew, but to you and I who are being saved, it is the power of God. There's power connected to the sacrifice of Jesus. Why? Because it stirs up the power of the Holy Ghost. It stirs up the power of the one who laid the heavens and founded the earth and put the Spirit of God on the inside of you. It stirs up the power of the Holy Spirit to begin to move and to operate in the midst of your circumstances. And so when the enemy thinks he has you, that's at the right moment of time for you in the midst of your brokenness, in the midst of your realization that you yourself can't get her done, for you to cry upon the one that can, amen? Yeah. And for you to look upon, like Israel will, to the one whom they pierced. Goes on to say in Zechariah 12:4, in that day, says the Lord, I will smite every horse with astonishment and his rider with madness. And I will open my eyes upon the house of Judah and will smite every horse of the people with blindness. Supernatural intervention of God again, causing the horses to become astonished, causing them to become blind. The point is that he has intervened. Amen. I've heard stories before in that six-day war. There was a six-day war, and I forget my dates, but whenever Israel became a nation again, and they had tanks out there, or it was actually whenever the Egyptians, I think, tried to come back and combat. Israel had already become a nation again. I think it was in the 60s. This is when the six-day war, 1967, thank you. And so Egypt, if I'm not mistaken, tried to mount an attack against Israel. And there were stories where there were men of the other side in tanks, and they were just hornets got up in their tanks and began to sting them, and they were just getting up out of their tanks and they were running, and they didn't know. It's supernatural intervention with God. Hornets showed up in their tanks, and these men were running. God showed up for his people then, amen. He's going to show up for his people again, and he wants to show up in the midst of your life, and he wants to show up in the midst of my life. And the way all this happened was that it was through the supernatural intervention of God, where he struck them. He struck the eyes of the horses where they could not see. Ultimately, this chapter tells us that in the Zechariah passage, that Israel is going to look to Jesus, and when they do, that they're going to mourn for him, and they're going to have a desire for the Lord like they never did before. It says in Zechariah chapter 12, and I really kind of split up, I cut the verse in half and I put them upside down. I'm not trying to do nothing crazy with the scripture, but I'm trying to make a point. Part B of Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10 says, y'all at Zechariah 12 too?
Yeah.
Amen. Part B of it says, they shall mourn for him as one mourns for his only son, and shall be in bitterness for him as one that is in bitterness for his firstborn. It goes, and then the first part of it says, I will pour upon the house of David and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and of supplications, and they shall look upon me whom they have pierced. And then they will mourn for him as one that mourns for an only son, and it's going to be in bitterness for him, and like it's in bitterness for a firstborn. You know, one of the points, that the reason that I kind of split it up at first was because I wanted to make a point. You can't mourn for God until God first starts to move upon your heart. Jesus said that no man comes unto me unless the Father first draws him. The Father draws by the person of the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit that draws us to God. It's the Holy Spirit that moves upon our hearts to mourn for the things of God. It's the Holy Spirit that opens up our eyes and allows us to even come to the place where we even desire to repent. I'm about to start talking to you. I do know some things about repentance. I'm just going to let you know. I have been in some places of brokenness in my life before where I truly repented before the Lord. So I do know a little bit about what I'm talking about to you this morning. And I saw this in this passage of scripture as I was reading it yesterday, that some things that have to happen in the life of the believer in order for us to truly repent before God. What we need to understand is that what will happen to Israel tomorrow is what God wants to happen to you and I today. Amen. God wants to bring us as individuals to this place today. They said, like Israel, there are many times that we find ourselves deceived by the enemy and surrounded by what seems like an impossible trap in our lives. But just as in their situation, so it is with ours. And we can't blame it all on the enemy, right? In the end days, the move by the Gentile nations to destroy Israel is partly conceived by the will of man. And in a similar situation, we can't blame it all on the enemy. And sometimes we want to get mad at God, but the reality of it is that no, we had a part to play in it. Amen? And so we just got to remember that. And God knows it. He's just wanting us to come to the realization of it that we had a part to play in it and for us to make it right. We already talked about the fact that Israel was ignorant, that they had been in rebellion against God, and that at the same time, God is still working through it all. You know, he said in verses 8 and 9 of Zechariah 12, if you can look at that. He said it twice. At the first part of 8 and also in verse 9, he said, in that day. You see that? In that day the Lord shall defend the inhabitants of Jerusalem. And then in verse 9, and it shall come to pass in that day. There was a specific day that God was waiting for to show his power and bring deliverance into the lives of his people. We should understand that God always waits for the right moment. I believe that with all my heart. You may understand what I'm trying to tell you right now. You may not understand. You might not even completely agree with me. And it's okay. We don't have to agree on everything. But I many times have asked the Lord, why is it that it seems as though the same truth going forth under the power of the anointing of the Holy Spirit can affect a person's heart at this moment in time the way that it does, but at the same time, it doesn't affect another person's heart over here the way that it affected this person. And you know what the Lord began to reveal to me? Because I was using my own life as an example, at least at that point in time in my life. Since then, I've had many other trials that I've faced, but nevertheless, I do know that at that point, the greatest trial in my life, when I heard the liberating gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm just going to be honest with you. I was listening to Brother Swagger on the radio. That's what happened. I was listening to Brother Swagger on the radio, and he talked about Romans 6. And he talked about the old man being baptized into Christ, being baptized into his death. And even as we were raised from the dead, even as he was raised from the dead, we too should walk in newness of life. And when I heard that, then he said this. He said, there's no water in the Greek text. When he said that, I knew. It was like, I hadn't even been, like, I'd always read the Bible, but I didn't even really understand the Bible. You understand what I'm saying? Like, I studied the Bible the best I could, but I'd never heard anybody talk anything about that. I'd never read the first book behind a Greek scholar. You know, I'd never been to Bible college at this point in time. It was the first time I ever heard anything like this, but I knew immediately what he was talking about. He said, this is a supernatural baptism that took place on the day that you got born again. The problem was that you didn't know it. You didn't know the transformation, the spiritual miracle that had taken place. And now that you know it, hallelujah, life can be brought unto you. Power can be given to you. And when he said this, I could feel the literal power of God on the inside of my car changing me as I was listening to him speak the truth on the radio. And then I'm so full of the fire of God now because God's liberated me and sin's fallen off of me. And it was like the enemy thought he had me surrounded, like he had Israel on that day. But then suddenly happened. It was like the enemy now is, he took a drink of it and he's intoxicated. He tried to pick up a stone. He's all incised and cut up, and his horses are all blind. And he because and it was like confusion on the enemy's part, because I just started walking in liberty and freedom and didn't even understand why. Didn't know the first clue, but I knew that God had showed up and was bringing freedom in the midst of my life. So I'm taking that same word and I begin to speak it to people around me. And I know the power of God was behind what I was saying then. Some of you might say, well, you lost it since then, brother. Maybe so. But I'm telling you right now, when I was speaking that word, then the power of God was igniting the very word of God. I can remember the first time I was at the clinic, and you know that paper they'll put on a table, and I'm talking to this Christian girl, and she's like, I have been away from the Lord, and tears just started streaming out. I'm like, it's okay, sister, let me explain to you what happened. I began to draw the stick man out the first time on the paper of the clinic table, and explaining to her that she died in Christ, that she was buried in Christ, but I can't tell you, that was just the first time. How many Christians did I talk to about this truth that is in the scripture that talks about how God has chosen to bring confusion to the enemy and liberty to the believer, yet at the same time, half the time it falls on deaf ears? Because they're not in a place where they're really prepared to receive that word for their life at that moment in time. They're not really in a place where they're prepared to receive that word to bring their deliverance at that moment of time. I really believe that the Lord revealed that to me. Yeah. I said, Lord, why aren't people always willing to accept you at your word, to accept the freedom that you're offering? And you know what the Lord showed me? He said, because just like you, they're willing to sip the poison one more time. They're not to the end of themselves. Mm-hmm. They're not, and I know what's in their heart. They tell me that they're to the end. They tell me that they're ready. And sometimes they mean it, but they're not really ready. And so the Lord prepares the situation. He prepares the situation. He prepares the circumstance. He's long-suffering. He's merciful. He's kind. He's got the answer the whole time. Amen. And he's just waiting for us to be able to trust him and to believe him in it all. But the reality of it is that many times we're not ready and we're just not prepared. The point I wanted to make in verses 8 and 9, he said in that day. He said it twice. He was waiting. He's waiting for Israel for a specific day in the future when he knows they're finally going to see it, their heart's finally going to be prepared, and what they're going to see is the one whom they pierced. And when they see that, they're going to mourn for him as one who mourns for an only son. So when it's all said and done in this scenario that we've been reading, is that God allows catastrophe to strike in the midst of Israel's life. He's going to save them at the last moment in time. But he allows catastrophe to strike. And sometimes God has to allow bad things to happen. I'm not saying that it's always that way. You understand? As a matter of fact, I didn't tell you the name of my message. I forgot to tell you the title. Is sometimes the promise is preceded by the pain. It doesn't always happen that way. Everybody's different. But the reality of it is that sometimes the promise of God is preceded by the pain. Because God has to orchestrate and get us into a situation and a circumstance to prepare us for the blessing, for his will to take place in the midst of our life. It's important for us to understand, though, that even then, even in the midst of catastrophe, even in the midst of the surrounding of the enemy, even in the midst of you coming to the realization that you are not going to be able to get it done, that you can't do it in your own strength, even whenever you know that there's no hope other than God, what you need to understand is this, is that if God did not move upon you, you still wouldn't repent. Amen. You still wouldn't mourn for the things of God. It's the presence of God. It's the Holy Spirit of God that begins to move upon the heart of man. Because see, listen to me. I used to think, man, people just need to be a little bit more broken like I was. They just need to be a little bit, that's what they need. They need a good little dose of something in their life to shake them up. But you know what I began to realize? No, man. No. The reality of it is that had I not moved upon your heart, When you found yourself in the midst of that circumstance, you still wouldn't have softened your heart towards me. You still wouldn't have bowed your knee to me. You would have instead rebelled against me. And I think it's important that we understand that and we know that it's God and His presence that has to be poured upon us. And that's what He said in Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10. He said, I will pour upon the house of David and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and of supplications, and they shall look upon me whom they have pierced. And he goes on to say, and they will mourn for me. They shall mourn for him as one mourneth for his only son, and shall be in bitterness for him as one that's in bitterness for his firstborn. The word pour literally is kind of like descriptive of rain. It's like the heavens opened up and rain just gushed out. I've shared that story with y'all before, but after the tragedy had struck my life, that's what I felt like happened. I remember crying out to the Lord, and it was like I had come to the place where I came to grips with the reality of who I was and how far away I had traveled. And it was just one simple word, whatever I said to the Lord, and it was like all of a sudden it felt like the heavens opened up and a deluge of grace came. And I'm telling you, when that happened, I was broken. You know what I'm saying? I was broken in the presence of God. I'm just here to tell you that on that day for Israel, on that day for you and I, wherever we are, God wants to pour out His grace and supplications. You know, grace is the word, what He's pouring out at that point in time, that grace is, there's a lot of different definitions for grace, but in this place, the idea is that it's the favor of God given to man who doesn't deserve it. You understand that man does not deserve the grace of God. Man doesn't deserve the favor of God. Some people don't like that kind of preacher. Like, wait, hold on a second, preacher. I'm a good guy. I never cheated on my wife. I never killed anybody. I never cheated on my taxes. I'm a good old boy. Let me tell you something. You were born of Adam, and even if you had never touched nothing you weren't supposed to touch, you thought a whole bunch of things that you weren't supposed to think. And nevertheless, what I need you to know is this, is that God pours grace. He gives favor to those who don't deserve it. Now, the big act of grace and the whole grace message of the entirety of the scriptures is the gift of grace that God gave us, which is the gift of His Son, which ultimately, what we know from Romans 5:17 is the gift that God gave was the righteousness of Jesus. He gave a righteousness gift to you, and it results in grace given to you. Amen? Because now you've been clothed with the righteousness of Him, you now have eternal life. Amen? And you now have access to the grace of God. And that day, God pours out grace and supplications on His people. Now, you know what the word supplications means? It means to ask for grace. Once again, I'm trying to tell you that even in the midst of a trial, even in the midst of a bad situation, if God doesn't pour grace upon the heart and cause it to move towards Him, then the heart of man will never turn around with supplications and cry out for favor and grace from God. But when God begins to move upon the heart in that situation and allows that heart to be broken in the presence of God, and now that heart begins to cry out and say, Lord, give me grace, He responds with even more grace. Amen. And ultimately, the result of it here is this. They begin to mourn. They begin to mourn because they begin to see the whole scenario. They begin to see the situation that has really and literally taken place. They see the one whom they pierced. Now, you know, I was all about the Passion of the Christ when it first came out. I realize now, I'm just going to be honest with you, it's got a lot of Catholic stuff connected to it, and it aggravates me, and we thought that Mel Gibson was all born again and everything, and he didn't do any save. I will say, though, that I do believe God used it to some extent. One thing that I think was pretty cool about it was, if you ever saw the movie, and maybe you didn't, we could have probably thrown a clip up there. We would have probably had to steal it from somewhere, though, and I know that's not of the Lord. But that scene where they nail... They got a Roman soldier's hand on that nail, and he sticks it on Jesus' hand like that, and then he drives the nail, the first nail that goes in Jesus' hand. That was Mel Gibson's hand. He said, I made that happen like that. Why? Because I nailed him to that cross. Now, whether he's got a true, I don't think he's got a true revelation of what Jesus did, because if he did, he'd be a completely different person. But nevertheless, something's going on in that little noodle of his for him to say that. I nailed that nail there. Whenever, this is what's going to happen to Israel on that day. when the Spirit of God is poured upon them and their hearts are open to move towards and to cry out for grace from God, and God responds with more grace, they're going to come to the place that they're going to see Him whom they pierced. And they're going to mourn for Him as one that mourns for an only son. I'm actually closing right now, but I want to talk to you a little bit about repentance. Two things that I noticed out of this passage that I believe to be true about true repentance. Now, when I talk about true repentance, I'm not talking about I'm sorry, God. That's not what I'm talking about. And true repentance is a place where the heart is, what we're going to see is a really deep thing that's taking place. But not only that, it causes change.
Yes.
Amen. And the word repentance in the New Testament describes a mind change. Like you've come to the realization that you were wrong and that God was right. And in reality, in Israel's life, that's exactly what's taking place right here. They realize all along that God was right. They were wrong. They rejected Messiah when he rode in on a donkey. And now they're realizing that he had the plan the whole time. They're going to repent and they're going to turn their hearts towards God. Amen. And the reality of it is that God desires for his people to do the very same thing. But what happens is that the pain that they are experiencing is like the bitterness of one that loses a firstborn child. See, for Israel, there was nothing worse that could happen. The whole promises of God rested upon the firstborn. The firstborn got a double birthright. The child, for a Jewish man, having children, multiple children, especially the firstborn, was like a sign of a blessing from God. Jewish people, if you know anything about Jewish culture, if you've read the Bible for yourself, then you begin to realize that they are very emotional in whenever they feel pain. I've talked about it before. We say it in a funny way, but it's really not funny. They'll rip their clothes. They cover themselves in sackcloth, which is like burlap, on their naked bodies because it's very uncomfortable. They'll take ashes and rub it all over their head and their face because they truly desire to mourn. Now, thank God you and I, that's not how we have to mourn, but there's something going on there. Sometimes it's a display. I remember there was a song that I've told y'all this before, where the guy says, I don't need a grand display, just rend your heart. In other words, a lot of times we can put on a display for God, like they did. You know what I'm saying? I mean, there were sometimes they were probably for real. I mean, I believe David's heart, that's what he did. He didn't take a bath. He didn't anoint himself with oil. He laid right there and fasted, laid on the floor as he repented for what he had done with Bathsheba and the way that he killed Uriah the Hittite. I believe that was true repentance as the understanding of what he knew, okay? But what's taking place here is that it's very emotional. I was flipping through the channels last night, and it just happened to end up on the Jewish television network. I don't even know why, but I was so bored, I guess. I left it on there, and I started watching. It was some movie, but they had their own commercials. And they had this guy that got up there who was, I guess he was an Orthodox Jew, and he had on tap shoes. And he started tapping, and he was like a really good tap dancer. But all of a sudden, they started throwing up these subliminal messages. And they said, doctor, lawyer, scientist, you know. And then it said, get your Jew on. And what they were trying to say is that we're the Jewish people. And that we accomplish great things. And that if you're a Jew, then you need to get on board with what your heritage says. That's what they were basically saying in that commercial. These people believe that of themselves, right? And they believe that they are the people of God. And it's a big part of their connection to God. And what I want you to know is that in this situation, I don't really know what that had to do with anything. I think that I wanted to make a point, but it didn't do a very good job of it. But the point is that in this repentance, that the pain of the loss of a firstborn, that it's something that's deep. That was the main point I wanted to make. It's not just a superficial, I'm sorry. It's something deep that takes place on the inside. But I need you to remember, you're not going to manufacture this. You're not going to manufacture this on your own. It's going to be the power of the Holy Spirit that's going to pour out grace and supplications on you and cause you to come to the place that you are going to desire to cry out. Now, if you could put up verses, that's the first thing. True repentance is deep. Second thing I want you to know is that true repentance is personal. And we'll close with that. If you could go to Zechariah 12:12. I just wanted you to see that. It says, and the land shall mourn every family apart, the family of the house of David apart, and their wives apart. the family of the house of Nathan apart and their wives apart, the family of the house of Levi apart and their wives apart, the family of Shimei apart and their wives apart, all the families that remain, every family apart and their wives apart. What stood out to me right here was that there was a dissecting taking place, a separation, if you will. Each family, it was described, it's going to touch the house of David. It's going to touch, I believe it's talking about Nathan, and then it talks about Levi, so that's the house of the prophets, the house of the priests, right? It's gonna touch that, because this is after David. This is many years after David's going on with his fathers. Nathan the prophet's dead, but it's descriptive of these people that were leaders in Israel. Okay, and so it talks about the fact that this repentance is gonna hit David's house. It's gonna hit the house of the prophets. It's gonna hit the house of the priests. It's gonna hit the house. It's gonna hit the wives. Mm-hmm. What the point is that repentance is personal. Nobody's going to be able to talk you into and tell you that what you got going on in your life, they can tell you that what you got going on in your life is wrong, but just because they tell you and they reveal to you that truth in your life, it doesn't mean that your heart's going to suddenly be broken as though you lost the firstborn. True repentance is going to be something that's going to take place in your heart, your personal heart, when the Holy Spirit deals with you and reveals to you what it is that's going on in the midst of your life. And so when it's all said and done, what I want you to know from this morning's message is this. Is that there's coming a day for Israel whenever God is going to deliver them under great turmoil. He's going to deliver them out and bring freedom, and he's going to usher in the next stage of human history. Amen. But in the meantime, you and I have to live our lives upon this earth today. Amen. And God sent his son Jesus the first time on a donkey as a savior. Amen. To die on a cross to pay the penalty for our sin. And to lead and guide us into right relationship with him. But we don't have to wait for him to come back in the skies to be the king of our heart today. Amen. Amen. God desires for us to allow him to be the king of our hearts today. He desires for us to come to the realization of where we are and really where we need to be. He desires for us to come to the realization that when we find ourselves in the midst of situations that we don't have control over, that we're to look to him and his power to deliver us out, if that's what we truly want.